KKHT wants you to meet three of the classiest guys in real estate.
I am Chris Kelso, the maestro of mortgage.
I am Rob Cook, the godfather of real estate.
And I'm Joe Orsak, the king of credit swing. And together, we're
the Real Estate Rat Pack.
Much like us, real estate right now is smoking hot. So whether it's buying, selling, or owning, you need to check out the Real Estate Rat Pack.
They're here to take your calls and answer your questions live. Call now, 1-800-808-5548. And now, the Real Estate Rat Pack!
Sounds so much better that way. So much better that way.
You know, Ashley's starting to warn us if the mic's on. I wish you wouldn't.
I know.
It's kind of more fun to kind of catch us off guard.
You'd probably catch us imitating ourselves, which would actually be pretty funny.
Yes.
Yeah, they have to talk along with the announcer every week.
They're here to take your calls and answer your questions live. Sigmund, we love you, by the way. We're not making funny. We just love the intro.
You know, I tried to get Sigmund to come to our event to announce everybody as they walked in the door. I thought that would have been a great thing to happen.
I get six days off with it, you know? So it's like if I heard it every day or something, I might get tired of it. But, you know, like 2 years later, I'm still, it's great.
Absolutely. I would thoroughly agree with you.
You know, we often do shout-outs, and I want to do a shout-out to Chris Kelso this week. Chris Kelso made a pledge.
He's across the room, Rob.
And he's across the room. and I'm shouting at him.
Hey, how's it going over there, Chris?
But Chris made a pledge, and he does this each month for a different charity. And for June, you did the Sunshine Kids. And
that is correct.
And yesterday, you handed a check of $2,100 to the owner of Berkshire Hathaway Home Services, Anderson Properties.
That is correct.
So thank you very much. And I know Mike Cuff was very, very touched by that.
Hey, it's our pleasure. You know, one of the things we tell everybody is, we are very fortunate in the real estate community in general, whether you be in the lending side, the real estate side, or any of the services in between, to be in a very strong market. And the least we can do is to give back to our community. And so one of the things that we do is we choose a new charity every single month to donate to. You know, the Sunshine Kids with Berkshire Hathaway Home Services is one of the ones we chose back in June. And we're going to continue to do more of those. In fact, you know, the Sunshine Kids is a great organization. You don't have to be in real estate to donate to it. If you're interested in going to it, yes,
we like civilian money.
Exactly. You can go out there and donate, to their actual website, or drop a check off over at Berkshire Hathaway's corporate office over in the Heights. You know, we want everybody to know that it's important to give out there, especially in Houston, where we're in such a good market.
It always comes back, and you know, Joe Orsak adopted that also for that RVM thing he does every month. He chooses a different charity. What was it?
It was Dogs for Law Enforcement.
Dogs for Law Enforcement this year, and that was really a really
cool
good
guys.
Organization, yeah.
There, you know, one thing I really enjoy doing is supporting local charities. Yep. Nothing against, you know, them being national, but I like when they're based here and they're really focused on making a difference in our community right here. And Dogs for Law Enforcement is another example of one of those organizations. They're small. They're just getting their organization off the ground. And growing it, so it's just a group of people that are passionate about making a difference in their community. I love being around those kind of people.
Right.
They have full-time jobs. They've got a life like everybody else going on,
right.
But they're trying to make a difference. They're working to impact our community, and that's an organization that's really kind of cool. They're raising money to get trained police dogs. That's what that was supposed to be.
Right.
We are professionals.
Trained police dogs into law enforcement. There's not enough of them, and they make a big impact in the narcotics searches and all that kind of stuff.
Oh, yeah.
They're more effective than officers. So anyway, they raise funds to train and get the dogs into law enforcement.
Well, and I know Chris very well over
at
the
cool
Metro.
Guy.
He's a really good guy. A lot of the canine unit over there is absolutely incredible, by the way, whether it be
I'm
HPD
just hoping
or
you can
Metro
get me off of tickets from now on.
Exactly. Every once in a while,
that's
right?
What it's really all about.
Chris, if you're listening,
I'm
man,
kidding, Chris.
You, bud.
I'm kidding.
So today we're going to be talking about real estate and finance today.
That is correct.
Yeah,
and, you know, once again, I was out trolling for guests.
Right.
And I ran
which
into,
is what you do.
It's what I do. You know, 4 or 5 days a week, I'm out looking for people.
And you know, and you ran into a great individual. His name is Doug Erty. Doug, big shout out for you, big dog.
And Doug's listening. Yeah.
And he is listening, absolutely. And Doug said, you know, I'm going to send over two of my top-notch agents that I want you guys to have over there to the show. And we said, absolutely.
Well, they certainly should be on television. They're both beautiful young women.
Yeah, they definitely have faces for TV, not for radio.
Yes.
We're the ones with the faces for radio.
I think we need to. I think we need to get the pack cam going at some point.
Well, we have
everybody be too jealous out there.
And anyway, but our first guest is up is going to be Jodi Manfred. Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
And so talk about, you were in another field before you got into real estate. Talk about a little bit about that field and how did you choose to get into real estate?
Oh, that's a loaded question. Well,
we like those questions.
I have been in marketing for over 15 years, and actually that started a long time ago. I guess it chose me. I didn't choose it. I started as an intern for Pennzoil right here in Houston.
Oh, wow.
Pennzoil.
Yes. And then from there, you know, after college, I went on to work for a national advertising agency out of Kansas City. I spent about 9 years there. And then in 2006, launched a marketing firm. I have a partner. It's called Max Web Media.
Max Web Media?
Correct.
Okay.
Correct. And, yeah, so I've spent the majority of my life working for businesses, helping them to become more profitable, helping that matchmaking process for them to connect with their consumers and market a product. So it's a natural for me when, you know, it was a while back I had considered real estate. I felt like it might be a calling. My husband's in the business. And very recently, you know, I have two kids, very involved in the community, do a lot of volunteering at the school, middle school, high school. And the traveling and everything that comes along with my profession was beginning to clash a little bit. So, you know, I had this feeling of what can I do where I'm using my skill set and what I'm very, you know, very good at and very highly trained at, but where I'm helping my neighbors and my friends and my community, and real estate's a perfect fit.
And that's the wonderful thing about realtors. This is what I consider the prime example of what makes a great realtor, somebody who is passionate,
right,
involved, and understands it's a relationship business.
And let me tell you, you know, one of the things I tell everybody for full disclosure, Jodi and I actually closed a deal here recently. And let me tell you, you know, it's a perfect fit for also for the show because, you know, one of the things, and I can tell you about this, is your passion comes through in your job and what you like to do. You're very successful at real estate very fast, which is absolutely incredible. But you also have what it takes, you know, to get out there and understand that you are running your own business. Being a real estate agent isn't a matter of just becoming getting your license and then moving forward. It's about creating your own brand. It's about creating your own opportunities, about running your own business, you know, within the Doug Erte team, obviously. And so, you know, it's neat to see that change you're able to make, you know, in transitioning into something very successful right there, and also understanding some of the nuances associated with buying a home nowadays, because it's not as easy as it used to be.
Well, yeah, you got in a time that it's not like this all the time.
Right.
And, of course, you do a lot of listing, I think, which is really the best way to do real estate is to be a good lister.
Right.
It is the lifeblood of the industry.
I'm a good listener. What?
And thus,
but I digress.
That's his listening.
Anyway, and you're actually just, right now you're about to close $1.2 million home.
Yes, right? Sir, $1.29 million. Well, and you brought up a good point because something that I'm seeing, and again, you know, I'm not an old school agent who understands what Houston was like 5 years ago, 10 years ago, 20 years ago.
It's irrelevant.
It's irrelevant, I think, for sure, because right now we're seeing crazy things in the market. And one of the issues in the market right now is it's exploding at such a rapid pace that appraisals are not keeping up. So
We actually had an appraiser on about, 3 weeks ago talking about that subject because it's still an issue out there. You know, we're going to be talking a lot about numbers today. So the appraisal's a big issue with talking about financing and things like that. So tell me how long you've been in the business now.
Just under a year.
Just under a year and already productive. That's amazing.
Yeah, you know, it's always a lot of fun, you know, to see individuals like Jodi come into the business, you know, and be as successful as you can right away. And that's a testament, though, to not only who she is, but also understanding how to brand and market. You know, how have you transitioned from where you were doing to what you're doing today? And before you do that, actually, I forgot to tell everybody, you need to do a big shout out to your sons, especially one of them who's a really good football player from what I understand.
Yes, shout out to Josh Manfred. He's actually going to be on a segment soon called Rising Stars.
Right.
And he's preparing to play his first year of middle school football at Atascocita Middle School. Go Tigers.
Go Tigers.
Very good. All marketing.
Absolutely.
Start marketing now. So
exactly. You got to start marketing now.
We should
that's
go ahead
where the
and get his autograph now while it's cheap, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly. So,
but to answer your question, you know, Chris, I think that's kind of what has been has helped me to become successful at a very rapid pace is the marketing aspect of it, because what we're seeing right now in the market is a lot of relocations, especially particularly in the area where I am working, which is areas 1 and 32.
Which means nothing to our consumers out there.
That'd okay, so let me break it down.
And Woodlands.
Yes, we're Kingwood, Atascocita area, Woodlands area.
Right.
A lot of relocations. A lot of people who, you know, don't know what HAR is, know what HAR.com is. So that marketing aspect of being able to reach out, you know, nationally and even globally right now is extremely important. You know, and just the presentation, all of my listings I do videos for, all of my listings have a web page. You know, we do keyword marketing and a whole lot of other tricks I don't want to give away. But
with everybody intently listening, let me see what else she does.
No, you know, here's the reality of it. You know, some people are very guarded about what they do. I tell you what, you can go give everybody your entire arsenal, but only 5% of people would adopt. I promise you that is an absolute fact. You know what to do, but you're willing to do it. And that's what.
It's always execution. We live in the information age, and I talk about this all the time. From marketing standpoint, you know, as marketing, now more than ever, anything you want to know, it's there. The knowledge is already there. It's out. Right. It's out there. People write about it, blog about it, everything else. And Rob is 100% correct on that one. It happens at least once a year.
Blind squirrel can find an acorn every now and then, right?
It's execution. That's the killer, is that the average person just won't follow up on the email, return the phone call, answer the phone when it calls. I mean, I can go down the list. How basic is it to just answer the phone?
Right.
You know,
I want to give you my money, answer the phone.
Yeah, absolutely right. Yep.
It's amazing. It's amazing. And so we're talking about financing a lot today and stuff.
Right.
So have, in your time that you've been here, what's been your experience in people getting financing?
I'm laughing at Jodi because that's actually a great question. You know, Jodi and I, one of her deals that we did, we worked on together, and it was probably a good exercise and case study in regards to appraise value, credit, financing, challenges associated with that. There was a whole thing. And while we can't talk about anybody's personal credit or, you know, or anything associated with that, we had a deal that was pretty challenging. We had a deal that was challenging in regards to, first and foremost, the appraisal that came back. And the appraisal didn't come back at value, so that was a whole negotiation process. And then we had an issue with a client who unfortunately made some changes on their credit, and so we had to overcome that a little bit.
Made some changes.
And
I like that word.
Yeah, exactly. You know,
they made some changes on their credit.
Adversely impacted their credit. And then, you know, part of financing is also understanding about where the assets are coming from and how to buy that home. And so sometimes, you know, sometimes there's individuals out there that you have to work through a lot of different aspects through. And it can be challenging because, you know, you've got the listing agent who wants to know why you're not closing. And you have the buyer not understanding the true process associated with buying and selling a home. And you have somebody like Jodi who's in the business saying, we need to get this done because if you don't, in another month, I'm probably going to end up losing this, which is the truth, by the way, because he couldn't afford it afterwards. And then you got me on the other side sitting there going, I'm doing my best. And so there's a lot of challenges right there. And I think it's always important to understand that in those areas, it's important, and Jodi and I probably showed this the best, is it's important to have a great team because at the end of the day, if you work together, and Jodi can talk about this, you're always going to pull it through.
You know? Have to
but
know
the challenges along the way sometimes.
You have to know that statement made some changes to his credit is never followed by, I went ahead and raised it 100 points.
No, never. Never on that, yeah. Yes.
You know, it's like a football analogy. Sometimes you lose yardage, but you still can go get the touchdown.
That is.
So,
yeah, I don't know how you do that.
Well, after you get the next, you know.
After you get the next one right there.
Yeah. So anyway, we're coming up against a break.
We are coming up against a break again. I mean, time flies when you're having fun. You know, these segments go by so much, but we are talking about finance and credit. We do have the Dougherty Group here in town in studio with us, and we're going to come right back.
I won't dance, don't ask me. I won't dance, don't ask me. I won't dance, madam, with you. My heart won't let my feet do things that they should do. You know what? You're lovely. You know what? You're so lovely. And oh, what you do to me. I'm like an ocean.
Welcome back to the Real Estate Rat Pack Radio Show with Chris, Joe, and Rob. The crew is taking your calls, so dial in at 1-800-808-5548.
And we are back. You know, one of the things that we had done this morning that we forgot to mention in the very first segment is we are eating breakfast. We're eating a really good breakfast. And, you know, we have a really good partner in the studio who showed up out of the blue and just said, I want to bring you guys some breakfast because you guys are that cool. I don't know if he really knows me or not if that's the case. But, you know, we have Perma Pier in the house. How you doing, bud?
I'm doing awesome. I'm here, so I'm better.
Yeah. Right? And we also do a shout out to Jason's Deli, which actually was the provider. And John has a relationship over there, and I'm not going to throw you under the bus this time.
Oh, no buses here.
Anyway, well, thank you so much for bringing breakfast. We really appreciate it.
No,
so,
just real quick, as a sponsor, I want to thank the Rat Pack for the opportunity to come out and be a part of this and be a part of the network and just really learn and grow in the industry with everyone. So it means a great deal to me as an industry professional to be able to be part of it.
And he was telling me that the people that are in the corporate headquarters in Dallas were listening to the show. And I guess they heard your segment where
sent the check. Holy cow!
Man, I put the stamp on it. So
yeah.
Glutton's for punishment. Remember, there's nothing dry about a good crack.
That's right.
You know what? We have 70, 80 shows up on the website. That show is the only show I've went back and listened to multiple times.
Oh, it was hilarious. It was absolutely great.
I played the segment for somebody just a couple days ago. The last segment. Oh, my God. We were all crying again laughing. It was
we tell everybody, if you're out there, if you need any type of foundation repair, somebody go look at your foundation. You know, if you're an agent out there and need to refer somebody, if you're a client out there or a listener and you have any issues with foundation or at least need to get it checked out, definitely give Perma Pier a call. Great individuals. John's right here. John, how can we reach you?
You call our office at area code 713-849-9993 or visit our website at www.permapier.com.
You know, and that's what you get whenever you bring, you know, free breakfast every morning. So, yeah, we expect it next week as well.
We need to get our car sponsor on.
Yeah. There we go.
Brand new Porsche every weekend. That's great,
right.
Huh?
That would be awesome.
Well, guys, once again, I want to thank you guys. I hope everybody enjoys breakfast. I know there's some leftovers over there. I got to hit the road. I got to go do my job. So,
John, will you take it easy? But great seeing you, and thanks again for breakfast this morning. You know, it's one of those things that we tell everybody. Part of the Rat Pack is it's about showing up, about having fun, about just hanging out. You know, we do a lot of events, and we do a lot of stuff with a lot of our good sponsors, and Perm Pier is definitely one of them. I'm going to give a big shout-out to them as far as all the good things you do. Thanks a lot, John. You know, so talking about real estate and finance, obviously Jodi and I were talking about a deal that we had together. You know, and one of the things I think that was important, you know, if you look back, I'm one of those individuals that always looks back at deals. You know, I look back and say, what can you do better? What can you do worse? You know, hopefully not worse, but, you know, what was so bad that you could do better?
What can you do worse?
Exactly. I'm sure we can do a lot worse. But, you know, one of the things, though,
this time she's thinking it's coming on the show.
Yeah, exactly, right? Is, you know, and you know, we were talking during the break, and Rob was like, well, did you disclose this? Well, did you tell him this? Well, did you tell this person this? Did you tell this? And, yeah, you know, you can't teach listening skills, unfortunately, right? You know, it's one of those things, people hear what they want to hear. And so, you know, one of the things I took out of it, though, and I still say that today, it's about always making sure that all parties are well involved in the process. It's still the best way to do it, because challenges are going to arise, changes are going to happen, people are going to do things that they thought was in the best intention when it ends up doing something that impacts the file negatively, unfortunately. And it's just a matter of, I tell everybody, is sitting down at the very beginning, going through that process. You know, we've recently implemented a new loan process, I want to say, diagram that really details out now to every client that comes in, here's the process from origination to close, and this is what it looks like. And we've actually done, I think, a really good job on people are visual. So it's a visual illustration of what that looks like versus me talking to them and telling them. Because people will forget a lot of times, but if you show them something in visual format, believe it or not, we've already seen it. They'll come back and say, oh, I did, yes, because I remember that you said after processing it goes to underwriting. And then after underwriting, I've got conditions. And after conditions, you're going to do some additional, you know, verifications right there. And so
I think it's like marketing gurus would know, there's like 6 times more powerful to have a visual than it is to, you know, read it or tell it. people are very visual.
I would absolutely agree with that. But I also think, you know, too, there are a lot of first-time home buyers, I'm sure, that, you know, Chris, you deal with. But it's a very confusing process. There's so much information coming at you at one time when you're in the buying process. And even if you've done it 100 times, from my experience, no deal is the same.
None are. So, you know, that's a very good way of putting it. You know, and part of that reason is the following. I mean, if you look out there in the industry, you have FHA loans, which are federal housing loans. You have a conventional loan, which is what, you know, Freddie Mac and Fannie Mae are. You have a USDA loan, which is the rural development loan. You have a VA loan, which is a Veterans Administration
now
loan.
You can acquire using reverse mortgage.
That is correct. You've got reverse mortgages out there. You've got a jumbo loan, which are loans above 417. And then within those parameters, you have different types of documentation. You have a self-employed documentation. You have a W-2 employee, which is somebody who's on payroll. You have an asset base. You have a foreign national program. You know, so then you've got different aspects even within there. And you're right, no two files are ever alike. Why? Because I'm sure you file your taxes differently than me. I'm sure your income is different than me. I'm sure the way you do things from a financial perspective is going to be different than me. It's not right or wrong. It's just different.
Yeah. You ever had a situation where somebody was a W-2 employee, then come to find out he also owned the corporation that was paying him?
That is correct. That is correct. You know, you know, one of the things also is, you know, that's why it's very important. I tell everybody is whenever you're qualifying, whenever you're going to your loan officer, whether it be me or anybody else, present all the facts up front. Present everything up front. You know, just because you earn a W-2 income, if your tax returns have a loss on them, I can't just use your W-2 income. I would have to offset the unreimbursed business expenses or any losses you have in regards to real estate owned or any losses you have in regards to Schedule C or any additional businesses that you have. I mean, oftentimes, for example, we see that an individual might come in and say, yes, I work for Big Oil and Gas A. Okay, and then we get their tax returns, and it ends up that they have a side business, which is a consulting business. They only really, you know, in their minds, they only do it for, you know, whatever purpose it might have right there, but it ends up being a $20,000 write-off every year, mm-hmm. right? That $20,000 goes against the income of their W-2. And so what ends up happening is your net income ends up being a lot different. That can be a huge difference, a very big difference between qualifying and not qualifying anymore. You know, the other thing I tell everybody all the time is, you know, don't max out your debt-to-income ratio. So many times individuals come in and say, I want to see what the max I can qualify for. And my first question to them is, what budget do you want to stay within? Because qualifying for the max, and Joe knows about this, qualifying for the max is just like maxing out a credit card. It's not the right thing to do. Know what your budget is. You know, if you want to qualify and your budget is a $1,500 monthly payment, don't try to qualify for a $300,000 home. Because it's just, the numbers aren't just going to match up, right? You know, even though you can go in this industry right now, your government loans, you can go up to 50% debt-to-income ratio. On your conventional loans, you can go to 45% debt-to-income ratio. On some of your other loans, 42% DTI. You know, on your jumbo loans especially. You know, you want to try to stay within a reasonable. I still tell everybody the rule of three is probably the best, you know, which is use one-third at max to qualify. Remember, we're going to qualify you off of gross income. It's not net income. So when I look at your income, if you earn $100,000 a year, you know, you're really probably bringing home more like $70,000 a year. But again, I'm going to qualify you off of 100. So no, don't get too caught up on that aspect of things. Know what your budget is that you're going
to
be living off.
Remember, we used to do a 28-36, and we were selling lots of real estate, and interest rates were 15 and 18% at that time. And so it makes a lot of sense.
You know, the reason why we got into trouble in this industry in general was because you know, and again, I saw it for, you know, I've been in the business now 12 years, almost 13 actually, is that we saw way back in 2004, 2005, 2006, 2007, individuals qualifying for homes with debt-to-income ratios of 57, 60, 62% debt-to-income ratios, okay? I mean, people would walk into my office and say, I was told I could qualify for this, but I just want a better rate. And I'd say, you don't need to be buying a home at a 62% DTI.
Oh, wow.
You know? But that's part of what happened right there, right? And so I tell everybody is never qualify based on the home you want to buy. Qualify based on what your budget and what you can afford, and then find the home accordingly.
Well, you know, we had a lot of balls moving in the air on that deal because in 1999, Clinton signed into law something that would allow subprime loans.
That is correct.
We used to call it B paper.
Right, that's
correct. Now it's called subprime loans. And then the feds also said, went to everybody and said, you're going to put this money out.
Right.
Because what they want to do is make home ownership available to
affordable.
Everybody.
Yeah, that's correct.
The thing is, it didn't make it affordable, and not everybody is responsible enough to own a home.
Right. There are some people who should not. You know, the one thing I've always told everybody is, just remember one thing, though. The one thing, and this comes from an industry, and I tell everybody this all the time, is, you know, everyone wants to blame the finance companies for the debacle that we had in 2008. And let me tell you, it was both sides. It was the consumer for accepting it, because I can tell you plenty of consumers walked in my office and said, I want to get this no-doc loan. True story. Walked in and said, I want to get a no-doc loan. I said, why? He said, because I don't have a job. I said, then you shouldn't be getting a home. Right? And he said, no, but I can qualify for a no-doc loan. I said, that's not what it's meant for. A no-doc loan at that time was not meant for somebody who didn't have a job. It was meant for somebody who had a job, who just couldn't prove where their income was, but had other factors compensating it, right?
And a lot of our doctors and attorneys who operate professional corporations, and they never show a lot of personal income.
So I told him, I said, I can't qualify you. I can't get you in. He said, you know, if I walk out of here, I can go to one of 10 other people and get into a home. And I said, then go to one of 10 other people and get into a home, because I won't do it. 3 days later, he's in an office closing, walks down and says, guess what? I told you I was going to close on the home. And I said, you better make sure you get a job and can afford to pay it. 1 year later, he comes back to me and wants to know if I can save him, because he still doesn't have a job. His payments have gone up, and he doesn't know what to do. Okay? Yet those stories are not told in the industry, right? What's told in the industry is
how bad
Wall Street was, right? And don't get me wrong, Wall Street did some bad things. I'm not going to defend either side, but both sides had equal play into this problem.
Chris, I still think I'm going to get a job.
Exactly.
You should really take care of the loan for me.
You know, I've been trying to look for you, Bob, but it's getting tighter out there, man. Well, you know, time flies when you're having fun, or when I'm talking, actually, one of the two.
It doesn't fly for me, Chris.
Exactly. Whatever, guys. But time flies when you do have fun and you're talking about finance. When we come back, we're going to continue to talk about finance and credit, talk about some of the interesting things on credit, and bring Kari on to say some things as well.
Kari's why not? She's been sitting over
very patient. No one puts Kari in a corner.
Hasn't even threatened to hit me or anything.
Absolutely. We're going to take a break, though. We'll stay tuned. We'll be right back. And that's a recipe for making love. It doesn't need sugar, because it's already sweet. It doesn't need an oven, because it's got a lot of heat. Just add a dash of kisses to make it all complete. And that's a recipe for making love. If you've made it right, you'll know.
Welcome back to the Real Estate Rat Pack Radio Show with Chris, Joe, and Rob. The crew is taking your calls, so dial in at 1-800-808-5548.
And we are back, having a good time as usual. You know, listen to me talk.
We were once again discussing Sigmund during the break. He gets a lot of airtime with us here.
He really does. You know, and you can listen to him during the week, by the way. He hosts, and I still think he does, he hosts one of the shows during the week in regards to one of the Bible study opportunities.
Really?
So, yeah, really, really good guy. Knows his stuff. Great individual. Just a great person and an incredible voice, you know. He follows me around in my head the whole time. Chris is walking into the room.
Yes. Oh,
wow. Well, you know, we had Kari sitting over the corner. I thought we ought to bring her out into the sunshine.
Nobody puts Kari in the corner.
Nobody puts Kari in the corner. Let me say, bring her out into the sunshine, talk to her a little bit. You know, one of the things, you know, Kari is brand new into real estate. She's brand new also on the Doug Erte team. And, you know, one of the things I think would be really good is for you to say hello to everybody, by the way.
Good morning, everyone.
And more importantly is also talk a little bit about what interested you in real estate. Why did you get involved with real estate? Because you have a very interesting background. Talk about your background first, I guess, and then why you decided to move in the real estate market.
Okay, sure. Well, thank you for allowing me to be here first. I started off as an intern, a financial analyst for Hillcorp, and I was in the finance industry up until about 3 years ago, and was trying to look for a new gig. Wanted to get out from underneath the fluorescent lights 8 to 5, and really interested in homes, and decided real estate would be it for me.
And you know, and you say really interested in homes, you know, you're a Houston native.
Yes.
You know, if I'm not mistaken. So you've seen the growth in Houston. I mean, you've really
Tremendous growth, just
from a living perspective. You know, I mean, I'm not a Houston native, even though I've always maintained a home, or my family's always maintained a home in Houston, you know, for the past 40 years. But it's amazing some of the growth that we've seen over this period of time. You know, not only here recently, but if you look back in Houston in the 80s and you look at it where it is today, and we're not talking about, you know, 100 years ago. We're talking about 30 years ago.
Yeah, I remember back 100 years.
Yeah, exactly. Well, yeah, Rob does remember 100 years ago, but, you know, I'm a little bit more youthful.
I'm well seasoned.
So, but, you know, but you've seen a lot of those changes, and you see, and houses have changed a lot during that time frame as well.
Right. And especially over in the Woodlands location where I'm working, it's just boomed so much in the past 10 years. It's gotten really big. And all around, and most of it is still coming along with the new companies. Exxon moving in. It's bringing a lot of other new businesses in. And the Woodlands itself has more Fortune 500 companies than some small states do.
Oh, I can imagine.
And so that's been really good for the economy.
You know, I watch economic news a lot of times, and they talked about that, you know, Texas is creating the bulk of all jobs in the country.
Oh, yeah.
It's all happening right here. And just wonder, see, if you have conservative principles and you make it easy for businesses to open up, businesses come here. Isn't that a strange thing to have happen?
But you know, one of the things that we see also, you know, as a lot of individuals coming into town, as we're seeing a lot of foreigners come into town, as we're seeing a lot of people relocate even within the United States, because one of the things we're seeing is a big relocation. One thing that's happening is people are having they're having to become more in tune with their credit, Joe.
Yeah, that happens.
what a segue here.
But you know, one of the things though is, and you know, Joe, obviously with Improve My Credit USA, he has been voted the consumer number one ranked, you know, consumer credit based organization. I don't want to ruin it or anything like that. But, you know, or I don't know how to repeat
consumer
it that well.
Consumer voted number one credit repair company in Texas for
you've
the last
got that memorized.
4 years, and consumer voted number one credit repair company in America for right. 2014.
You know, but what are you seeing? I mean, what are you seeing in reference to clients right now? I mean, a lot of people are coming in. They're trying to get into this market that we've got right now. You know, how are you seeing, and what are some of the issues that you're seeing in credit-wise?
Well, there's, you know, lately I've ran into a couple interesting things. You know, my industry, at the end of the day, I tell folks it's if you want to hire a credit improvement company, a credit repair company, the common idea, street person, and I understand it's normal. They want the attitude of, I'm hiring you to delete the bad stuff and make that go away and make my scores good. But that's right. Not why you hire a credit professional. That's kind of the pie in the sky, you know, fairy dust.
Now, wait a minute. I saw a billboard the other day.
Yeah.
And they guarantee you a 700 credit score.
Yes. Yeah.
You don't guarantee me 750 if I go to you, like, today?
No. Okay. In fact, it's illegal to make those kind of claims. much to my annoyance, those people are out there. The reason why you hire a credit professional is to make sure that what is being stated on your credit profile, all three of the bureaus, is accurate. That's the thing. And unfortunately, they make it so convoluted. I mean, if the average person looks at a credit report, it's gibberish.
Right.
I might as well be looking at Latin, you know, because it's very complex. And there is a movement out there with some large companies trying to make that an easier to read, easier to understand process and all that sort of thing. So we are making headway, but it's still very difficult. And what happens is that difficulty allows you know, less than scrupulous vendors to just flat out do illegal things.
Yeah.
And I'll give you an example, one that because of what happened in 2007, 2008 with all the foreclosures and what we experienced in the market that I've seen quite a bit of is with the 1099.
Right.
I'm sure you guys have seen this where a person is 1099, they had a foreclosure, the property was resold, and then the remaining debt, the person received the 1099 as income. For the amount that was owed.
Because the debt was forgiven.
Yes, but... because the debt was forgiven. And you said a key phrase, because the debt was forgiven. All right? What I've seen a lot of creditors do is illegal, and they have a nice little way of trying to get around it, but it's illegal, is that they will charge off the debt, 1099. And a 1099, if anybody can look it up, it's on the internet, go to the IRS's website, pull it up. It says on the form, cancellation of debt. I don't think that's too vague.
Right.
Cancellation of debt. Yet, they will 1099 a person, report it as income, you got to pay taxes on it, and now they will sell the debt to a collection company, and the collection company is trying to collect on it. It's illegal.
Right.
You can't both cancel the debt and try to collect the debt.
Cancellation of debt doesn't mean collect on debt?
Right, right. Exactly. Yet I see this. They'll also try to pull another fast one, which is they will have charged off the debt 2008, 2009, whatever, and now 2014, they're 1099-ing you for the income. Can't charge off a debt in a different year than you 1099 the consumer for it. Has to be the same year. That's right. Another one that they're pulling, bunch of shenanigans. So here's how they try to get around it. They 1099 you, you get it. Now they sell the debt. They want their cake and eat it too, right? And the collection company's calling, and if they collect, if they get you to pay, then the company will turn around and file an amended 1099 reporting a zero write-off. The right. government allows them to amend it. So in effect, that is said, oh, oops, they really didn't owe any money. That's how they make it legal. But while they're trying to collect, after it's been charged off, that's all illegal. Can't do that.
And one of the things also has been a lot of stuff out there is there's a lot of stuff that collection companies and those creditors try to do that are illegal. Number one, if you're asked not to be contacted at your place of work, they cannot contact your place of work. They cannot call you after a normal business hour, which I think is 8 p.m. in the afternoon. Yeah. They cannot use threatening language to try to collect a debt.
Yes.
In other words, they can't threaten you to say, if you don't do this, we're going to take this action.
I promise not to call you anymore, Chris. I promise.
it's crazy, Rob. You know, there's a lot of stuff like that still.
There's a ton of stuff like that. You would not believe the stories that I've heard of things that collectors have pulled. I had a person tell me that a collector physically showed up at their place of employment to discuss a debt, told the manager that they had to speak to them about a financial matter. You can't show up at somebody's employment, place of work. You can only call an employer once, and that's to verify employment only.
Right.
That's it. Beyond that, it's harassment. It's illegal. Right. Yep. There's all sorts of rules like that that the consumer's uninformed, so the collector just runs rampant with it. They just run all over the consumer's rights. On that note, you know, I've got an article that I wrote on our website, What to Say When Creditors and Collectors Call. Because there's a lot of little things that they try to get you to do, verbal contracts, when they tell you that the conversation is recorded, all this sort of thing, they try to get you to admit to the debt. So you take ownership of it and to express a willingness to pay.
Right.
Right. Whether you say I want to pay or not, it's just whether you admit to wanting to pay, make a payment plan or something doesn't matter. Just that, hey, I want to pay you on this. I just can't. You just admitted to the debt. Now they get to update your date of last activity. So there's a lot of little stuff like that that they try to rope you into these conversations to jack with you on your credit. That's really all it boils down to. Because they know once, you know, there's some things about how credit scores work that really are in the consumer's favor. For instance, 80% of your credit score comes from the last 24 months. So once it goes outside of 24 months, the impact really goes down.
Right.
Right. And it really starts tapering off quite a bit past that. So what happens is when these collection companies buy a debt that's multiple years old, 4 years old, now they're calling on you, they know that the impact it's having on your credit is pretty minimal. So they want to get you to do those mistakes. They want you to make a little payment, anything, because that gives them the ability to update the date of last activity, bring it back into that 24-month period, and tank your score again.
Right.
Now you have a lot more motivation to try to deal with it. So there's just so many things. I mean, I could go on for freaking the rest of the show and talk about how much collectors, yes, and beyond the show, and talk about how bad collectors, ruin customer rights.
No, I would absolutely agree right there. You know, and the other thing is most people don't realize is there are a lot of rights that consumers have.
Yes.
You know, we as consumers have to fight this.
Absolutely.
And most people don't know where to go to or don't know what to say or don't know how to do it. You know, a lot of it's good information out there. The other thing, though, I will tell you, there's a lot of bad information out there.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And you know, we're coming up on a break, but that's the eternal question of how do you know? One thing, just to wrap up on that kind of point right there, how do you know? One great thing about the information age is we have a tremendous access to customer reviews.
Right.
Right? There's reviews on everything these days, right? just type in the company name and reviews and see what you find. And you're going to have the crazy review, and when you read it, you usually know it's crazy. And you're going to have the bogus review that's glowing, and it sounds like it was written by a sales professional, because it was. Right? But you can take that medium range there, and you can kind of get the feel for the company.
Right.
You know? I highly encourage people to do that. We use a managed review service on our site. It's a third party. They investigate every review. I can't write a review. It gets booted. They track our IP and know where it comes from and all that stuff. So I highly recommend doing that. And that's a good step towards knowing you're working with a professional.
And
company.
The writer I had write your review for you, I think she did a really good job. By the way.
It was fantastic.
Anyways, we're coming up against a break again right now. Next segment is going to be open mic segment.
Student loans. Yes. I'm going to mention some stuff on that.
Yes, we'll come back, talk about student loans and a lot of other stuff. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Welcome back to the Real Estate Rat Pack Radio Show with Chris, Joe, and Rob. The crew is taking your calls, so dial in at 1-800-808-5548.
And we are back. You know, the good thing is that we really didn't find a topic that Joe was passionate about.
Yeah, you know, so Joe, I want you to repeat everything you said on the break.
Yeah.
Ready?
I'm still going.
Yeah. By the way, whenever break went, Joe went into overdrive.
But we do want to talk about the student loans, because you were kind of broaching the subject with me the other day, and it sounded like a pretty interesting program.
Yeah.
To help, people who have, you know, they're coming out of college right now, $100,000 debt, higher.
There's the one good thing. I tried to get one of my credit consultants to come down. That's trained and knowledgeable on the subject.
Randall's not trained,
but unfortunately, he got an appointment scheduled this morning and couldn't come. So I'm kind of out in the cold on it again, because he's more intelligent on the subject than I am about the student loan thing. But the short version is that back in 2007, actually, it's a while back. The government really made a lot of a push to give people options to get student loans back in shape. If it's a government-backed loan, we run into in our business, one of the credit issues that we see very, very commonly is student loan issues.
Right.
And from a lending side, you can speak on this, you know, more with more expertise than I. If it's a government-backed loan, you're not going to get a government loan.
Right. If it's in default, no.
Yeah, that's what I mean. If it's in default. So, and you know, the principle I tell folks with the dealing with the government, if it's a tax lien or anything else, the government gonna get theirs.
Right. No matter what.
Right. You aren't gonna get around it. Right.
Yeah.
They're gonna get their money. So you might as well bite the bullet and deal with the situation. The good news is on that, we've really done a lot of research recently. And we've got paired up with a lender and an organization that has a bunch of different options and some amazing options. Depending on where you're at, income-wise, all that sort of thing, there's one program that is a debt forgiveness program, up to 85% of the student loan based on your income.
Oh, wow.
As long as you're going to get into a payment plan and all that sort of thing, they have that program. And then it kind of scales up from there. They have all sorts of options for you. You know, the amount of payment you have can just start off at a really, really minimal amount to get you back into a current status, and then it scales up over so many years to allow you time to build your income up and all that sort of thing. But multiple options to get your student loans back on track, and that's the key factor, because for us, when we're dealing with the credit improvement process, if I'm going through and looking at all the negative items that are reported and we're making them verify the information, whether it's accurate or not, and stuff is being found to be inaccurate and double reported and all the crazy stuff they do, and items are being removed, yet at the same time, your student loan is dinging you every month in default with a late payment, it doesn't matter. Your score is still going to stink at the end of the process.
Oh, yeah.
You know, that's one of the filtering questions for us. We actually turn people away.
And nothing good but a stinky loan, by the way.
Yes, nothing good about a stinky credit score. We turn away about 30% of the people who come to us because they just wouldn't be good candidates for credit repair. And that's one of the key things is, are you still, are you currently late or in default on a payment? Are you paying a credit card late? Are you paying a car note late or a house note? that type of thing. Because it doesn't matter if there's, you know, if you had 10 negative items on your credit and 9 of them were items that we would typically work on and could help a person with and verifying their accuracy and all that sort of thing, but you had that one current late payment, it doesn't matter. We could get all 9 of those items removed, and on our side, we're high-fiving in the halls. You know, we're rock stars. We did a great job. On the customer side, they're going, y'all stink. You took all my money. You didn't do anything. My scores haven't went up because of that one late payment, because that is the thing that will be tanking their credit score.
Oh, yeah.
So student loans, when it comes to that, a shameless plug for my credit consultants at the office. You can give them a call. It's a complimentary consultation. And the student loan thing, I have to look up the number for the weekend thing. I'm still, I just like realized that.
Sad.
But see, I am prepared. I wrote it down.
Yes.
713-936-0589. That's our weekend telephone number. Or you can just go to improvemycreditusa.com and put in your information. But they can give you with a very, I'm talking just like a matter of seconds, looking up information, can give you options to get your student loans on check, and some really, really great options.
I mean, it's great to hear that passion you've got, Joe. no, but it is important. You know, we tell everybody all the time is, you know, one of the things that you have here in the studio at all times is a great credit guy and a great mortgage guy who can always talk about finances, you know, and something we're both passionate about.
Yep.
So, you know, it's while we joke with each other about that, it's something very real. I mean, you know, and Kari and Jodi, as y'all probably see all the time as well, you know, finance and this aspect and credit-wise is something that's very real. I mean, Jodi and I went through it in one of our closings, but it's something that you have to be prepared for. You have to understand, know the process, know how to work through the process. I tell everybody is, there's always a way to work through something, you know. And Jodi can attest to this. When she called me up one time and she was really, I would say, freaking out a little bit about the deal, I said, we'll work through it. There's always a way to work through it. It's just a matter of what time frame and then, more importantly, how that mechanism is going to work.
And I want that information as before anyone gets in my car, I'm going to have as much information that credit is good.
Absolutely.
And first of all, you don't want to get them excited about buying
but
a house.
But credit is not the only predicator of getting somebody in your car. You know, so that's why I tell everybody all the time is just because somebody says, yes, I ran their credit and they have a 750 credit score does not predicate them getting into your car.
But it certainly helps.
It helps, right? But there's a lot of other factors that go into pre-approving somebody.
So talk about that a little bit.
You know, well, before we do that, I wanted to ask something because my mind sometimes goes off. You mentioned something about a broker drive-by or something, Kari, and I wanted to have you talk
about. Well, it's more of a flyby than a drive-by.
Flyby,
yes.
Okay. What is that? Talk about that.
Well, I know you guys just hopped off your jet and all, but we have a...
gassed up and ready to go.
Right. We have a plane, and right now we're offering these broker flybys. We're also inviting buyers, qualified buyers, and sellers to take a ride up and view houses from the sky.
Awesome.
It's a cool way.
Wow. So, really?
Yeah.
I think I'm looking for a new house up in the Woodlands area.
That is really
I'm suddenly
neat.
Interested.
So it's a flyby then?
Yes, it's a flyby. So we're hosting those out of the Conroe Airport.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's actually a really, really, really good idea. You talk about marketing and doing something different. That is something that is really, really neat because most people don't realize it's also really neat if you've ever flown above Houston.
Many times.
It's really neat to sort of see the changes. And sometimes what you don't see on the ground, you can see above in the air. And I've had people tell me, I didn't end up buying this place. Why not? Well, because I saw that there was a big moat right behind me or there was a big tower right behind me, and I saw it as I was flying over, right?
Right.
And so very good idea because you can see things that, you know, that you know, eye level you really can't.
You're seeing a lot more drone pictures in marketing nowadays.
Yeah. Right.
People are flying their drones, taking photos, and for that exact reason, you can see what's in the air. But it'd
and
be a lot more fun to get on a plane.
Yes, it's a fun,
and
exciting
NSA
way to
has
get
a,
to
the NSA has a website where you can go and view. No.
Oh, wow.
realestatebeingmonitored.com. No, I'm just kidding.
But it's probably true.
Yeah, it is probably true.
Talk about those other things. I've got somebody got a 750 credit score, and all of a sudden they're not qualified.
Well, you know, so when you qualify somebody, it's a lot more. Credit is a very important factor, right? Because credit is one of those things. Is credit's like knocking on the door, right? You're still not in the house, but you've at least knocked on the door. And so that's what credit does. It says, okay, right now you have a credit profile that's going to enable you to move forward. That next step in moving forward, though, is, What's the number one thing that that person has to do to qualify? It's income. Okay. The second most important thing is down payment, so assets. But income. So when you look at somebody's income, then again, we get back to the tax returns. You have to look and see what type of individual they are. Are they a W-2 based employee, or are they a self-employed borrower? If they are self-employed, there's a two-year history requirement of self-employment history. There's a two-year requirement of tax returns. You have to average it over the past 2 years. Now, there's some factors that can go in as far as maybe they take some deductions or some depreciation that you can add back in regards to income. But you have to look at those items. If you're W-2 income, then you still have want to look at the tax returns for some things I talked about, as if you have unreimbursed business expenses or a Schedule E or a Schedule C, or if you are an investor and have multiple real estate transactions, we need to see what your real estate transactions look like and if they are a positive or negative in regards to income. So that's your next biggest step, is look at the income. So don't just go off a prequal and say, guess what, they got a 750 credit score. Make sure that's, hey, I have reviewed their income and assets in conjunction with their credit, and they are pre-approved to get out there and buy a home. That's the way to do it. Sounds in a nutshell.
In a nutshell, huh? Well, you know, we're coming up like 3 minutes.
We are coming up with 3 minutes as usual.
And so what we typically like to do is kind of like, you know, go around and see what you want to leave people with. So, Jodi, what do you want people to know about you?
You know, I think the one thing I want to do first off is give a shout out to the Dougherty Group. Thank you, Doug, for
Thank you, Doug. We're enjoying this. We're glad you couldn't make it.
One thing I want to say though about the Dougherty Group, and I think this is really important, because you know I always say my place or my business plan, if you will, is to be very great at something, but not to be everything to everybody. One thing about the Dougherty Group, we are very specialized. So, you know, what I am targeting and very specialized in luxury and lakefront property right now. We have others that are extremely, you know, great working with buyers or relocations, but very targeted specialized agents. So, you know, I just want to leave people with, you have that option. And, you know, look around and make sure that whatever your specific needs are, that you find someone to work with who you know, can best fit those needs and has a lot of experience in that specific area.
It's a relationship business. Now, Kari, I know you're new in the business, but I know there's a new person's perspective. What would you like people to know?
Well, I'm just really excited right now to get started and bring my corporate experience into it. And our new office is opening in the Woodlands on Market Street.
And when's that opening up?
September 1st. So.
I expect to be invited to the party.
Yes. The party is, yes. You'll be invited.
Tell people how they can get a hold of you.
Yes. You can get a hold of me on my website. It's www.thewoodlandshomeexpert.com. Or on my cell is 832-233-2483.
Jodi, I don't think we asked you that question. How can we get a hold of you?
Absolutely. I have a few websites. You can go to jodimanfred.com. It's J-O-D-I-M-A-N-F-R-E-D. Or easier, jmluxuryhomes.com. And by cell phone anytime, 832-273-0867.
That is awesome. And Joe, how can I reach Improve My Credit USA one more time?
You know what? I'm going to give folks my direct line, 832-239-5206. Never done that before here. 832-239-5206. If you've got student loan issues, give me a call. I'll get you with the right person.
And as always, you can go out to realestateratpack.com. You'll get that information. Today's quote, no different than anyone else: the most difficult thing is the decision to act. The rest is merely tenacity. That's from Amelia Earnhardt. So until next time, we are out.
And you've been listening to the Real Estate Rat Pack. The question is, who's Frank, who's Sammy, who's Dean, and who's the other guy?
Chris is Frank, he's Dean, and I'm Sammy.
Yes, he's Dean. That's right. Yeah.
So tune in to the really big show every Saturday at 9 a.m. right here on 100.7 The Word, KKHT.